entrepreneurs here. Is anybody familiar with the term social entrepreneur? So some nodding heads, okay, nodding heads. So do you want to explain to the group what a social entrepreneur is? Goods and services that make an impact for good beyond just having a business model. Can you guys think of any social entrepreneurs off the top of your head, well-known ones? I'm actually not familiar with that. Is it an acronym?
No, it's awesome.
Oh, USOF.
Yeah.
Oh.
Sorry.
No. Okay. Are you talking about First Microcredit?
Yes.
Okay. Yes. So yeah, First Microcredit. If you want to share what First Microcredit does for folks. You can guess. Yeah, that's okay. So I mean,
I don't want to provide wrong
information. Yeah, no, that's totally fair. At a high level, my understanding is that they provide banking services for regions that typically don't have access to banking services. Right?
First Microcredit is the financial institution located in the south of the Republic and provides financial services to individuals.
So, right, but not typical like city individuals, right? They also have a focus on providing financial services for people who typically don't have access.
Actually, to all individuals.
I see. Okay, so it's both people who are local in the city, as well as people who are, got it. Okay, so there's a few people who are from First Microcredit, and they are participating in the Social Entrepreneurship Lab, because one of the products that they do want to provide is to be able to start providing financial services for people who are out in more rural regions. So it seems like somewhat related, but okay. So social entrepreneurship is kind of that, right? Is you're creating a business that goes beyond just making money, but you're actually trying to make an impact. And a lot of times, people who are starting social entrepreneurships are really focused on, hey, how do we do good? How do we make an impact for doing good, right? But it's also important to have a sustainable business model. So a lot of us came here and we were teaching some lessons around some of the methodologies that are common in the Bay Area for how do you think of your business plan, how do you be innovative in terms of your products and your services. So I have a quick example later on that kind of ties into this, but if you guys have questions about it later on, feel free to come and ask. All right, okay, stalling for enough. Thank you guys for waiting patiently. So, today I wanted to talk about listening, the art of listening. It might seem like a very strange topic to you, right? Why is somebody from the Silicon Valley coming here and talking about listening, right? Why aren't they talking about the big new technologies that people in Silicon Valley are creating, AI, machine learning? None of that is bad. It's great to learn about it. But what I wanted to share about was something that I think is one of the most important skills that you can have, regardless of whatever sector you work in, whether that be technology, banking, law. It's a skill that I think if you can do well, then it will help you be successful professionally anywhere. So a quick introduction about myself. I'm Jennifer. I am from the Bay Area originally. So Bay Area, we use that term when we're talking about San Jose, Mountain View, San Francisco Bay Area. It's a lot of it is part of the Silicon Valley. And I, for the most part, was born and raised in Silicon Valley. I grew up in San Jose. San Jose has a lot of big tech companies you might have heard of, like Adobe is based out of there. If you guys are designers and use Adobe Photoshop, if you go downtown to San Jose, you'll see their big skyscraper. So I grew up around technology, grew up around Silicon Valley. And when I went off to college, I went to UCLA, which is University of California, Los Angeles. It's in Southern California. Who here has been in California here before? Anybody? Okay, we have a few folks who have been in California before. It's like 5 hours away, right? And I haven't looked at a map to map how far one end of Kyrgyzstan is from another, but in California, you know, Los Angeles is right, maybe around a 5 hour drive away from San Francisco. And the culture is pretty different. It's not as much of a tech hub. But when I went down there, I decided I still wanted to study engineering. So I went to UCLA. I studied electrical engineering because I wanted to do something that was technology related, having grown up in the Bay Area. But at the same time, I actually decided to take a class. I decided to pick up a minor. My minor was theater. Very random, right? Very diverse, right? Theater, engineering, how does that even mesh together? And I think you'll see throughout this entire presentation that having technical skills is very important, right? But just as important as your technical skills are your humanities skills, are your soft skills, right? I can't code in this language maybe, right? Languages change all the time. You know, what is it? Like JavaScript 6.0 now? I don't even remember, right? But like every single year, you'll have to learn new technical skills, technologies change. Those are important, right? But people skills, those are things that you can carry throughout. And you'll notice that as you get higher in your career, as you begin to work in larger organizations, you're spending less time on your technical skills, and you're spending more time on these soft skills, stuff like listening. Anyway, so I graduated from UCLA engineering, and I was studying engineering, and I was minoring in theater, and I didn't really know what I wanted to do with my life. I think a lot of people don't know what they want to do with their life when they're in college, right? So when you're in America and you don't know what you want to do with your life, you do something called consulting. Because you're like, oh, yeah, I don't really know what I want to do, so I want to go to a lot of different companies and kind of see what else is out there. So I went and I joined a company called Accenture, a very large organization, hundreds of thousands of people worldwide. They provide all sorts of services to businesses that may not specialize in, you know, business process management or, you know, providing customer service support. So I did some fun projects there. Like, for example, are any of you familiar with the Affordable Care Act? No? Okay. Maybe the American healthcare system. Anyways, I won't ramble too on there. I was hoping just to kind of like tie throughout why my experiences have kind of poured out and helped me learn lessons in this talk. But you know, when I was at Accenture, I spent a lot of my time focusing on more business-oriented problems, working with you know, big CEOs of hospitals, right? And it was funny because I was, what, maybe 22 years old, 23 years old, and I was going and having these meetings with these big CEOs who have been in this industry for a long time, and yet, you know, some of the skills that I learned were, you know, being able to listen, being able to engage and have a good conversation, and being able to hear what they needed. So I spent a few years there in consulting, and I decided I miss doing more technology-related work. So I ended up moving to a company called MarkLogic. I worked in product management, and it was focused on database systems, which is why I was asking you about Oracle. Are you guys familiar with what product management is? Okay. When you start a project, analysis, development. So project management, yeah. So project management, there's multiple terms you might hear, and it differs on company. There's project management, program management, product management. And I'm going into the detail because I think you'll understand why I'm coming, where I'm coming from in this presentation. So project management is, you know, a lot of times focus on how do I complete this project? What are the tasks that I need to do in order to deliver this product? So for example, if I need to build an app, well, within the first week, let's schedule a timeline. First 2 weeks, let's do some prototyping for the design. Next 2 weeks, let's start building, you know, and let's have a wireframe out and begin to share with, you know, our customer to show what we're building. Next 3 weeks, we're going to build the actual app. And then by X timeline, end of the month, we're going to actually have a product, right? So that's kind of the project management that you're thinking about. So product management definitely has a lot of elements of that, but a lot of software companies in Silicon Valley have actually a separate role that is dedicated to asking the why and the what questions. So whereas project management might be very focused on the how and the when, you know, and some of them do have a lot of elements of the what and the why, in the Silicon Valley and the software world, they have dedicated roles that are purely focused on the what and the why. Why are we building this? Why is this feature important? What are we doing this for? What are the customer's needs? You know, we're building an app, and the customer wants us to do 10 different things, and we have this timeline to hit. But what do we cut? You know, what are those most critical features that we have to build in time so that they'll still be happy? But, you know, we don't have to push back our timelines, right? Things like the minimum viable product. I don't know if you've heard of that term before, but like, what are the key critical features that you have to deliver in order to somewhat be successful? And so that's what I do. And throughout this talk, you'll understand why it's important to know how to listen, because understanding the why and the what is really critical in having a good trained ear for making sure that you're listening. So anyways, spent a few years there, got exposed to product management, and then I decided to join Google. So at Google today, I work in product management. I specifically focus on YouTube advertisements. Do you guys watch YouTube? Yeah, okay. You guys know what YouTube is? Yay! Right. And so you might think it's funny because, like, what? You focus specifically on advertisements? Yes, because advertisements are what makes YouTube free. And fundamentally, you know, our users for advertisements, we have multiple customers, right? We have you as a user who's watching an advertisement. We have local businesses or businesses in the area who want to buy advertisements. And we also have creators. Like if you put your content on YouTube, right, and an ad shows on your content, you're also a customer of that advertisement, right? So even working in ads, it's a product, right? You don't want to just throw some random ad on there. It's a product that you really need to think clearly about. To say, like, out of the balance of all users, how do I balance all of them? And I can share a little bit more about that later if you're curious. Okay, so I thought I'd pick maybe, you know, one person to quickly share. I'm kind of curious about the crowd here, about who's here today. If you want to share your name, where you're from, what you do, and why you're here.
My name is Talal Bekeshev. I just graduated from high school. I'm having an internship Technologies as a web developer learning Python. I'm learning front end. Then, when I get familiar, I will switch to the back end. And that's how I'm going to spend my summer. I'm here today to learn more about, like, how to say skills, people skills, and more like motivation to get to the skill.
Sharing. Yeah, maybe just one more person. Who here? Yeah. Just want to get a flavor of the crowd.
Right. Hello, everyone. My name is Raj, and I'm from one of the local companies called IT Attractor, and I work there as a software engineer. Well, I came here just to grasp your vision of what is the art of listening and how it can impact my work and my kind of day-to-day life.
Sharing. So we got a good flavor of people here who are working already, who are students. And thank you for sharing why you're here. So I'll try to have this presentation oriented towards that. So why listening? Right. I've kind of repeated this multiple times already. But I think I really want to hammer at the point is that some of the best communicators are also the people who are the best listeners. Think about the friends in your life, right, who listen to you, who you chat with, or maybe your bosses, right, or your managers, right? They're people who listen to you and actually want to hear your input rather than just talking over you. And listening is very important, especially in the world of building products or building services, because a lot of times what people say not what they actually need, right? They'll say, and we'll go through some examples later on, right? Like, what does that mean, right? But people may say something, but it may not actually address what they're actually wanting. And finally, I wanted to talk about it because I'm bad at it, and I want to improve. I think it's a skill that anybody can keep improving on. And you'll find this, but Americans love to talk, and they're not very good listeners. I feel like since I've been in Kyrgyzstan, you guys have been very good at listening. So I probably have a lot to learn from you guys. So this is a slide that's a little bit hard to see, but it's a comic that sort of makes fun about how product development can fail because different people in different departments see something different about products. So I'll read it to you because you can't see it, right? So here's a little picture of a tree. There's three swings, right? And this is how the customer describes it, right? They're like, okay, like this is the customer said, I want a swing, you know, that I can sit on and I can go as high as I want, right? There's variation, right? And you're like, okay. And so the project leader comes to them and says, like, okay, I think this is what they want, you know, like, I think this is what they want. Because maybe they didn't listen and they didn't ask, like, where on the branch they wanted the swing, right? And then you go down to how the analyst designed it, right? The analyst is like, okay, like, let me make it as complex and efficient as possible, right? And then how the operation installs it, right? They just install a rope, right? And then you go on to how it was documented. Basically, it doesn't even exist. There's no documentation. How it's supported, well, they just break it, right? It doesn't even work. I mean, you get the point, right? How they advertised the open source version. So great, $0, and you get everything with it. You even get a couch, right? You know, how they applied open source patches. So they're just like, okay, let's just patch all these things around it. Multiple things. How the business consultant describes it. Like, oh yeah, you're gonna get this amazing product. It's gonna be so soft. The sun is gonna be shining. It'll be the best thing you ever buy. You know, how the program actually writes it, right? It's gonna swing side to a chon. What the better testers actually receives, right? They're like testing, like, what is this product that I'm actually even testing? What marketing advertise? I don't know, iSwing? Can you guys see the comment? Like, making fun of iPhones, iPod, if you guys have seen those advertisements before. Going on, yeah. And so, this is interesting, right? Like, this is what the customer actually needed, right? Like, just making fun of, that might have been what they said they wanted, but this might have actually just been what they needed, what they actually needed. And how it performed under load, it broke, and then what the customer recovery plan is. So this is just an example of how, you know, when you're building a product, right, like multiple people are saying multiple things about the product, and it just turns out different and it looks different based on whoever you're talking to. It's another example, right? You want to build something and you say, yeah, like, you know, I think our users are happy. I haven't heard any complaints so far, but they're all in their building, right? And they're not outside looking at the crowd, and there's a bunch of customers who hate their product, right? And like, what this all reflects is different people hear different things, and they'll translate it in different ways. And here's an example of, if you're not out there listening to your customers a lot of times and trying to engage with them, then you might build the wrong thing, or you might have that wrong impression about how successful. So what do people mean to say? Right. So this is a quote that people often use by Henry Ford. They're actually not sure if Henry Ford ever said it, but it's very iconic, which says, if I had asked people what they wanted, they would have said faster horses. Are you guys familiar with Henry Ford? Yeah. Right. He's the creator of Ford cars, right? If he had actually gone out there and he had asked people, like, hey, what do you want, right? They would have had no idea that they wanted a car. They would have said, oh, you know, like, I want a faster horse, right? But if he had really gone beyond what they had said they actually needed and said, oh, they want to get to places faster. They want something that's more efficient, right? And you're no longer constrained to the idea of what the customer thinks they want because they may only be familiar with the world that they see around them. So before I go on, I think this is an extremely important point to hammer on if you're building products, or even if you're talking with your bosses, or even if you're talking to your friends. I don't know if you guys have ever experienced this before, but you go and you ask your manager, like, hey, can you provide feedback on my project? Can you show me what you want? Right? Or can you share? And they'll say something, right? And later on you go back and you say, hey, here's what I actually did. And they're like, no, this is not what I want at all, right? Like, I don't know if you've ever experienced that. And you're like, wait, what? I thought this is what you said you wanted me to do, right? And then you realize, like, after digging furthermore, sometimes people at meetings just say things, and they're like, oh yeah, we want this, we want that. Like, how, why don't you change this? Why don't you change that? Right? And you kind of have to parse through their feedback. Like, sometimes, even, for example, a presentation, right? People are like, why is there a period on that slide? Like, oh, I want this, this is, you know, like, can you change this box over here? Can you talk about this instead? And like, I want you to highlight this point. But what they're really saying is they have no idea what I'm saying on the slide, right? Like, I could shift all the boxes all over the place and I could do what they're telling me in those 2 or 3 minutes of feedback and try to match exactly what their feedback is. But they'll come back and they'll be like, they still won't get it. They're like, actually, can you change this? Can you move this or whatever, right? And so in that moment, you have to realize, or I have to often realize, is okay, they just don't understand what I'm trying to convey. So instead of asking them for feedback, like, well, what do you want me to move on the slide? It's either, well, what do you want me to, what kind of message do you want to convey on the slide, right? Or what are you struggling to understand from what I'm sharing, right? And it's those types of questions to think through, where you know people may spend all this time providing you feedback. And you may implement exactly what they want, but it's not what they want, and you actually end up wasting a lot of time. Which is why sometimes if you just take the time to listen and dig deeper, you can actually save and be more productive. And so the next few slides are about things that I've learned about how do you listen better. And these are things that I'm still trying to learn. So the first one is being present. How many of you guys have a cell phone? How many of you guys have just texted during my talk? It's okay, I won't be offended. People don't have to say, okay, cool. No, it happens all the time, right? Or like checked your email or been distracted. How many of you guys have suddenly blinked out and like thought of something else and then missed a sentence that I said? Yeah, right, happens all the time, we're human, right? But one of the first things that is the hardest part about listening is just being present. And I think especially in our world today where we have so many distractions, we actually end up being a lot less efficient. So the first thing is just being present, right? Like, here's kind of a fun little comic. I really like comics, right? Someone wants to be like, look, honey, I just got a new phone, right? And then, you know, daughters are like, look, I got a new boyfriend. You know, or maybe the boyfriend said that. And I don't, you can read the comic many ways. And the guy's texting, he's like, did you say something? Right? Happens all the time, right? And so there's this myth today in our world about multitasking, right? That efficiency and productivity comes from doing multiple things at once. You know, in this 1 hour, I'm gonna text a friend, I'm gonna call them, I'm gonna email, I'm gonna go to 5 meetings, or I don't know if you guys do this here, but at Google, it is a terrible, terrible habit that you go to a meeting, you have a 30-minute meeting, you sit down, and you start typing, because you're chatting with a person in another meeting, or you're answering an email. You know, and someone is presenting, and then someone will then ask, like 5 minutes later, wait, what about this? And the person will think, like, I just said that. I just said that 5 minutes ago. But the thing is, everyone's distracted, right? They're all distracted, doing other things, and what ends up happening is you actually end up having multiple meetings talking about the same thing. Because in that 30 minutes, they didn't hear what you had to say, so you have to schedule another meeting, right? So I'm not saying that this is school, but I feel like there's a lot of places these days where people are so distracted, and you might see even more prevalent in a lot of high-paced industries, and a lot of times, especially as you go up the management chain, you have more responsibilities, and this becomes more difficult. So they've done studies that show, like, you know, you're doing one task, you're happy, but if you're multitasking, you're not actually doing multiple things at 100%. And you're actually doing something called like task switching. That multitasking is actually a myth. And what you're doing is you're actually rapidly hopping between one task and another. And there's a loss of time that occurs when you're trying to re-engage in a product. So some of you guys are programmers, right? Have you ever had someone go, hey, and like interrupt you in the middle of while you're trying to code something? And you're like, whoa, what? And you have to listen to them, you have to talk to them. And the moment you re-engage in what you're trying to do, you're like totally lost track, right? And then you actually have to take time, right? Like, what was I solving? What was the problem that I was actually doing, right? So I would say, for especially like when you're problem solving, you know, high concentration tasks, it's actually very expensive to try to multitask. People still do it anyway, but I'm just calling it out, right? Like, multitasking is not great, and especially with listening, it's difficult. So I'm actually going to show a little clip and have you guys try an exercise. Let's see. To kind of just show an example of like how difficult multitasking is.
In the summer of 2015, I finally got my driver's license. I was so excited that I'd earned the freedom to go where I wanted. My mum congratulated me on the hard work and surprised me with my favourite ice cream cake. As I took my first bite of the chocolate crunches, my mum told me that any time I wanted to borrow a minivan, all I had to do was fill out a 5-page request form that had over 30 questions on it. I'm so glad my mum treats me like an adult now.
Sounds good. What color was George's hat?
Green.
Green? Okay, very good. What was a girl reward after getting her license? During which season did the girl obtain her license? What did Linda have for lunch? Big trout. Those are the cat stories.